your questions. During the session, if you get any emergencies, you may leave the session and rejoin later if time permits. Make sure that no unnecessary sound is heard and nobody should interrupt their trainer by asking questions in between. You may use question and answer session for that purpose. All of you may use chat option and post your queries, suggestions, etc. We also request you to watch and subscribe our YouTube channel, Panchandra Planet, where you can see and watch our concluded sessions and turn on notification for the upcoming webinars. Now, I would like to welcome today's moderator, Mrs. Subbalakshmi. She is the principal of Geethanjali All India Senior Secondary School, Erode, and honorary secretary of Kongu Sahodya. She is an amazing powerhouse of knowledge, experience, and expertise. She is a very charming and ever smiling lady who is a very good trainer who works with many organizations. She, with her pleasing personality, beautiful smile, and pearls of wisdom, will lead this session. Madam, now I request you to take over this session. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shaiju. It's my pleasure to just organize this event, and I'm so happy that Panchatantra Planet has given me this opportunity to join you people. And I'm so happy to give the welcome address by Mr. Mukesh Shelat. Mr. Mukesh Shelat is the principal of DPS Varanasi, and he is also the secretary of Varanasi Sahodya. And he started as a teacher trainer with over 12 years of experience he has, and he is on the panel of CBSE, and he has a lot of training agencies like Centrum Learning, NDN 85, and Peak Point. As a freelance trainer, he has conducted sessions for reputed publishing houses like Oxford University Press, Orient Black Swan, and Macmillan and Pearson. We are so happy to welcome Mr. Mukesh Shelat to give the welcome address. So please.
Thank you. Thank you, Subbalakshmi. Thank you, Shaiju sir, for that very brief introduction. It's actually a pleasure to introduce a friend, philosopher, and guide. What do I say about Dr. Balasubramanian? I think the very fact that, you know, by 4 o'clock, the moment we started admitting people, there was a stream of people waiting in the room, shows that he has a tremendous fan following across India, not just India, but in perhaps the world. He was just telling me how he has traveled almost 27 countries during the COVID time, sitting from his home. This is the irony of the times. And sitting in Varanasi or sitting in different parts of the world, we are able to, you know, connect with Dr. Balasubramanian, who is such a stalwart in the field of education. I still remember we have a very deep connection, sir. And today, whatever little I am doing in terms of, I think, school administration or even teacher training, I think I would, you know, jaise Krishnarpan kehte hain, I would say I'm, you know, putting it at your feet. You have been my guide right from the first meeting that we had in the CBSE office when I came for the affiliation process of Adarsh Vidya Kendra. If today the school is doing so well, it is, sir, your good offices. You led me to the right person. Jaise wo sakhi ne Ram aur Sita ko milaya, you got me and the minister at that point of time to get talking together, and our difficult processes of affiliations, you know, were streamlined. Ever since then, you know, you have been always guiding me. Even if I changed a job without your knowledge, you tell me, "Arey, yenik swalali Adani." This is how you have. So that's the kind of, you know, I can just go on and on, sir, eloquently about your wisdom. But I think I don't, Radhakrishnan sir knows this, and I think he has given me a very limited time. So welcome, sir, from the bottom of my heart. It's a wonderful opportunity to listen to you all over again. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. So first, good evening, everybody. And I must thank Kongu Sahodaya, Malappuram Sahodaya, and Mr. Binum Adarsh Vidya Kendra, and of course, in particular, Mukesh, because I think I have grown 40 years younger today, because My first visit to Adarsh Vidya Kendra was something 35 years before, I remember right, for an affiliation when Mukesh was there. And from there on, you know, we have moved together. And I think that's a very interesting journey. And let me walk into my presentation directly. One second.
Waiting room at
a chair. I hope you are able to see my slide.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. Sir, please unmute, sir. Bala, sir, please unmute.
Frequently. Okay?
Yeah.
Mukesh, I think the scenario will take you to Varanasi itself, right? So, I'm going to start today's program with wishing all of you a very healthy time ahead, because, you know, the last 1 year plus has been a very challenging time, especially for the school principals and teachers. And very often I used to put a picture of the drummers of, you know, Manipur, where they used to have a drum and beat it on both sides and dance simultaneously with such a speed, even the Olympic medal winners will not be able to do that. And I think my principals and teachers have been dancing like that to the drums of, two sides, one on the NEP and the other on the COVID, and, really meeting all the challenges. And therefore, I would like to start by offering my salutations to the entire teaching community. The very important thing is, normally when we start the day, we start with a happy birthday. And today I'm going to wish, today is Olympic birthday, right? In 1894, it is 220 years now, the Olympic has been on. And you may be wondering, why do I start with the Olympic birthday when the topic assigned today is blended learning? Because I think there's a lot of significance of your choice of this date, because this choice goes well with your conduct of this meeting today. Because if you look at the motto of the 2021 Olympics, it says united by emotions. I think that's what Sahodaya stands for. All of you are here today, not because you have any personal agenda, but because you are emotionally connected to each other, because you have a common purpose of meeting certain challenges, especially in the context of the learning community. And therefore, the theme of Olympics, so united by emotions, fits in very well with the theme of Sahodaya. And very interestingly, finding Kongu Sahodaya with Malappuram Sahodaya, and I've always been seeing, because, the Sahodaya movement was started by me in 1986, right? The first circular with regard to Sahodaya was written by me. And people may not know that the first meeting of prayer to Sahodaya was conducted when I happened to be the secretary of the Association of Private Schools in 1984. And we had a meeting at Asan Memorial School. And subsequently, Sahodaya movement came in 86. And the first conference was conducted in 86. So we have now grown. And having two Sahodayas working together itself is a celebration to deal with that. So friends, the challenge today is that we are all going through a human crisis world over, both in body, mind, and spirit, right? So there is a lot of challenge to everybody, and every challenge across the country first impacts the school, whether it is a social change, cultural change, financial change, scientific change, technological change, whatever the change be, the change impacts the school community, because proverbially the saying goes, catch them young. And therefore, everybody in the field wants to catch the schools where the children are accessible, right? Therefore, we have a you know, the impact of COVID has, you know, impacted the school situation. And like any other warriors, my teachers, my school principals have been the warriors on the front, right? And no wonder the entire world is closed. You know, beautifully you could see a statement from the World Theater at New Jersey that the world is closed practically, right? The spirit of the world, when I say the world, probably some action may be going on, but the spirit of the world today is very much closed. And we have been counting on the numbers, the number of people affected, and also not only the number of people affected, the first COVID season, the second COVID season, and now people are predicting, God forbid, the third COVID season, which might impact us. So we have all been playing a number game, both in terms of life, both in terms of death, in terms of people who have been vaccinated, in terms of people who are not. And so the number game has been haunting the world across, right? So, I saw a very beautiful statement which I put across, a few days back in my Facebook, which says, all men's miseries are derived from not being able to sit quietly in a room. I think most of you would agree with me that we have all been imprisoned inside a room, right? Wherever you are, whether you are in Varanasi or Nagarkoil or Erode or wherever it is you are, all of us are constrained to a room and unable to move out of our situation. And so this statement is very well fitting to us, but very unfortunate, this statement was given some 500 years before by Blaise Pascal, the great physicist over there. So probably they also have had a challenge at this point of time. So historically, century after century, we have had the problem in 1919, 1920 with Spanish flu, and now this one coming to the COVID coming to us. So as I said, the two important factors that we have been facing is on one side, the COVID, the other side is the new education policy. Right. So people have been keeping their fingers crossed, and we have been suffering from a lot of phobias over there. One we call the fear of loneliness, which is called the monophobia, and the fear of time and space, because how are we going to spend the time? Because people have been busy for 24/7 and they don't know how to spend their time sitting at home. So you have got a chronophobia, and then fear of falling sick. You don't want to get out and fall sick. So you have got what is called emetophobia. And then the fear of touch. You don't want to touch anybody. Even a newspaper comes to you, you want to sanitize and do that. Therefore, you've got a hebophobia. And then you've got fear of visiting public places, what's called agoraphobia. Another last but not the one, the fear of the unknown, what is going to happen, the xenophobia. All put together, a new terminology has come called the phobophobia, our phobia for the phobia itself. I think that is a very complex situation that we are doing that. So all that what we have is two important terms which I want to use. One is a crisis, the other is a COVID. Now the other is a chaos. Now the challenge is that what we are facing today is chaos and not a crisis, because crisis always has a nucleus, but chaos is having no nucleus. It just like it comes a tsunami, like, and that's exactly what has happened. Almost every aspect of school education, be it is infrastructure, be it curriculum, be it pedagogy, be it assessment, be it public relations, be it emotional contacts, right? Be it finances, everything has been affected. So the school, every school has got a chaos, and therefore the other day I was talking to the Kerala principals on management of leadership in chaos. So the first thing that I would advise you before I walk into the topic concerned, not to press your panic button. These two will pass. And the most important thing for my principals across the country is to know that they have to keep calm, they have to keep quiet, you have to run the race along with somebody. But at the same time, I would like to compliment my teaching community, because in the month of last April, when things were in a very bad shape, I just thought how it's going to be difficult for the teachers to cope with what's going to happen, how will they conduct lessons. But let me tell you, my teachers across the country have made what is impossible the possible. I think that hats off to everybody. That's exactly what the great boxer said. Impossible is not a fact. It is an opinion. My teachers have proved across the country, my principals have proved across the country that they are capable of withstanding to any challenges, any kind of challenge. And therefore, let me get into my program by offering salutation to the entire teaching community. Teachers, wherever they are, you know, India is known for what is called a very characteristic term called the jugad, right? Whatever we available with that, they used to make it, things happen. And therefore, I think jugad or no jugad, they made things happen. Well, there could be, some negative aspects. There could be some deficiencies. Doesn't matter. We have kept the ball moving ahead. So that really takes me to a fantastic term, a proverb, which Alexander the Great said, that I'm indebted to my father for living, but I'm indebted to my teacher for living well. I must tell you that your children, your students are going to remember you that, my teachers taught me even during the most trying times, most challenging times. So that is the spirit that you have. So friends, with both COVID as well as the NEP coming through, people are raising a question everywhere. Sir, everybody's talking about a new normal. What is that new normal, right? I used to tell them that there is nothing called a new normal. New normal is a very common term. You should not press your panic button over that, because the day when the fire was discovered, it was a new normal. The day the wheel was discovered, it was a new normal. The day when you discovered the printing machine, it was a new normal. When the first computer started operating, it was a new normal. As a matter of fact, every morning is a new normal. Every time my teacher enters the classroom, it is a new normal. Every breath is a new normal. And therefore, don't ever be worried about the term new normal. And the only new normal that we have today is something that we are entering into a digital world. The children born today are, born to a digital world. They are called the digital natives. And therefore, when we were born with a small plastic ball in our hand, my children are born today with a mobile in the hand, with artificial intelligence in their hand. And that's a challenge my teachers are going to face in the days to come, that how to cope with the curriculum and pedagogy. Because in one of the conferences which I visited in Bangalore, the IT secretary made a very interesting observation. He said that, we are not concerned with relevance of knowledge, but we are concerned with irrelevance of knowledge. The speed of the knowledge is getting decreased. So in these circumstances, everywhere there is a talk of what is called the blended learning. So people do ask me a question, sir, when did the blended learning start, right? Whether it's the education 4.0 delivery, or whether it is with the fifth generation computers coming through, or whether it is a gift of 2021, post-COVID, all that, the question they asked me. But I want to tell you something very interesting, that the blended learning possibly started with the Gurukula system over there. Because when the gurus at the point of time asked the students to go to the forest and collect the wood for them, and the children need to know where they would go, what they would collect. When they had to collect the fruits and vegetables, they must know where to go, where to collect, what are the kind of animals over there, what are the kind of seasons over there. So they collected a lot of informal information. Beyond that, when they got to go to the community to collect their grains, they need to know the socioeconomic status of the people. In other words, most of the learning at that point of my time was absolutely informal. It was absolutely blended, because there was no textbook. It is all what is called the Shruti and the Smriti that they were adopting over there. Now, to me, one of the greatest blended learners was my farmer in the field, right? Why? Because when the farmer went to the field, he had to know about the soil, what kind of soil he had, how he had to grow, see the plant, what should be the weather in which you should do, what kind of manure you should apply, and how the growth will happen, how to harvest the plant, and how to store it, how to market it. All that he has to know. So he needed a bit of geography, he needed a bit of soil science, he needed to understand a bit of biology, he had to understand economics, he had to understand marketing. That was a fantastic blended model of learning. So let us not pat our back saying that the blended learning is the 21st century delivery and we are the owners of 21st. So don't be hard pressed with the knowledge over that. So one of the earliest books that was written on blended learning, which said blended learning is an approach to education. Remember one thing, it is just an approach to education that combines online educational materials and opportunities with interaction online. So please note one thing, that online mode of teaching is one of the significant components of the blended learning, as not the only component of the blended learning, right? Therefore, the blended learning is a much broad-based approach and not a technology-driven approach. That kind of a myth I wanted to remove from the minds of teachers over there, because everybody thinks that blended learning is... we have already been doing blended learning. As a matter of fact, if you look into the human system, right, we collected information from 5 different senses. And all these informations, the eyes used to collect 32 different inputs. The ears, got nearly 23 inputs. And all that put together, and it went to send to the brain. And in a nanosecond, it was all put together and the meaning was made. Therefore, the very human learning was a blended learning. All that happened, multi-sensory learning, which was integrated. I'll go a little deep into that later. Therefore, the first message I want to give you is that the blended learning is an umbrella-based learning. So your classroom comes into that, your library comes into that. So please, eliminate the myth that the blended learning is a gift of the 21st century. Probably the pedagogy that we have so far used is not a blended pedagogy. So what is the context today that the curriculum we adopted was unidirectional curriculum. We did not accommodate informal, incidental and accidental learning processes, but then we went only for a text-based learning and we adopted a pedagogy which was totally driven by the teacher. Therefore, it was autocratic pedagogy that we had. Therefore, we had a unidimensional learning and we move in blended learning from unidimensional to multidimensional from unipolar to multipolar learning, and that is the change that you are going to have in the blended learning. Now, when I told you about the Olympics, I draw the 5 rings of the Olympic. To me, I would like to link the 5 important dimensions of blended learning with these 5 rings, which are interposed with each other. And that, I think, is the best way you would remember. For example, curricular learning, co-curricular learning, informal learning, experiential learning, skill-based learning. All are entirely different, right? Overlap of each could come over there, but then we have dealt each of them separately. So when all of them are merged together, all of them are blended together, you have the real blended learning that is coming through. And you can't do that only with your textbook. You can't do that only in your classroom. Therefore, you need to adopt multidimensional strategy. So you find that in this particular model that the types of learning is blended. Now you come to the ways of thinking in a classroom. Now, your national education policy is talking about 5 important dimensions of thinking which have to be incorporated in the part of their learning process. One is the mathematical thinking. Please remember, mathematical thinking is not, thinking with mathematics or thinking through mathematics. Mathematical thinking is entirely a different concept. Scientific temper. Scientific thinking or temper is different from science. Study of science and scientific thinking are entirely different. Similarly, logical thinking is different from logic. Aesthetic thinking is not merely art and graphics, but it is an appreciation of that. Creative thinking, all of you know what it is. So now the National Education Policy talks about all these 5 dimensions and you have all of them put together in your curriculum, in your pedagogy. That's what is the other facet of the blended learning. The third dimension, that the strategies you are going to have, the kind of classrooms you are going to have, you will have your conventional classroom as a part of it. You will have an online classroom as a part of it. You will have technology-enabled virtual classroom as a part of it. In other words, where the self-learning of the children will take place. Web-enabled social construction of knowledge. That's what John Dewey as well as Vygotsky, when they talk about social constructivism. Today we have got Wikipedia, we have got Facebook, we have got other things where social construction of knowledge is taking place. And that's exactly the future holds promise for not individual construction of knowledge, but social construction of knowledge. And therefore, you will find web-enabled social constructivism coming through. And you will also find self-driven extended learning, which is going to be a part of that. Now, then you have what is called four important skills that are going to come through. One is cognition. The other is understanding. Third is application and skill. Fourth is called life skills and values, which you know, and art and appreciation. And then I'm not talking anything entirely different, all in consonance with the national education policy. That all that has been talked about in the national education policy have all come in together. So this is going to be another blending of that you are going to happen. So all that what I wanted to say.
Sorry, sir. Just a minute. Really sorry to disturb and interrupt in between, sir. I think some teacher or a participant has given your mobile to your kids. It's disturbing all other participants as sir is presenting an important thing. The blended learning is very much important and it's a very, very important topic we are discussing about. All participants can understand and cooperate, I believe. If anybody has given your phone to your kids, please get it from them, and it's very much disturbing.
Thank you.
Sir, really sorry, sir.
No problem.
Sorry, I interrupted.
That's a part of online learning.
Obviously, this itself shows it's a blended learning. How to operate and how to be careful when we are in the virtual meeting.
So,
for your patience.
When it comes to the learning, remember one myth two important myths I wanted to clear with you. One myth that online learning is blended learning. Remember, online learning is a part of the blended learning, but online learning is not entirely blended learning. Please note that. Because wherever I go, when I meet to teachers, immediately when I say, yes, sir, we are doing it online, right? Please remember that blended, online learning is one very minor part of the blended learning. Second is flipped classrooms. Again, many people tell me, sir, they also confuse between online and flipped classroom. They said, we send all the learning content to children at home and they come and do it. They think that simply flapping of opportunities between the school and the class is a flipped classroom. That's not there. Please remember, even a flipped classroom is a part of the blended learning and not exclusively blended learning. So these two myths you have to there. Therefore, the menu card for the learning has got to be, it is something like this. When you go for a lunch, a la carte lunch at a hotel, they give you a menu card. You have the freedom to choose the kind of soup that you want. You want the starters you want, the menu that you want, and the desserts that you want. And that's exactly that we provide through blended learning, a kind of a menu card for the learner so that he can learn the way he wants and he enjoys the delicacy of the learning. So therefore, the message is that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. Now, that's a very important thing. So anybody says that this is blended learning, that blended, it is like a 10 blind man trying to identify the elephant and one saying that the tail is this, that one. But remember, the elephant is much bigger. Similarly, the concept of blended learning is all pervasive, holistic, and that's a very important message that you need to have. Because as leaders in schools, as academic leaders, you have to have clarity of thought. And because very often people are, driven by some myths. For example, when the continuous and comprehensive evaluation came, many publishers came with the idea that, we have got a textbook based on CCE. I said, it is the most foolish thing that could happen because CC is a pedagogy. It is a mode of assessment and it can nothing to do with the textual content. Therefore, you cannot have a book on CCE. But that's how the people, sale came. And that's how, the market operates. Similarly, blended learning, when things come through, remember, blended learning is a holistic process, which you need to keep in mind. well, the market provides you a lot of support, a lot of opportunities for doing things which you can't do individually, and therefore you can avail that. So why do we need the blended learning? I'm going to give the 10 reasons to you why we need blended learning. One, it empowers self-learning. It empowers self-learning. I remember that the onus and the responsibility of learning here is transferred to the learner. Right? Therefore, remember the teacher's role here is absolutely facilitative, motivational, and therefore the responsibility of learning, the onus of learning moves towards the student. And that's exactly the NEP wants the learners to become self-learners. The second point, it facilitates choice of learning skills. Like in a classroom, you have got a what you call more authoritative model where the teacher delivers the care way he wants or she wants at the point of time. But then you find that, we have visual learners, auditory learners, kinesthetic learners, gifted learners, and learners with a moderate speed, what are all that? But then all these learning can be provided, facilitated through the learning, the blended learning, because the learner will have the freedom of choice to choose whether he will take a video mode or an audio mode, or he will take an experiential mode. The choice will be that. The third important thing that you will do is it facilitates stress-free learning. I think that's a very important thing. In a classroom, the teacher, there is a stress. Even if the teacher is a very nice teacher, the very thought of the teacher, the very environment of the peers in the classroom creates some kind of internal stress, both psychologically and otherwise. And therefore, it is very important for you to understand that in the blended learning model, the stress is minimized. I don't say the stress is totally eliminated, because psychological stress continues to be there, but you get only minimized with this kind of stress. The next factor is the blended learning is anytime, anywhere learning, because a number of inputs are going through where the learner can learn from wherever he wants at a time that he wants. So it liberates you from that conditions of time and space. And therefore, it is in any time, anywhere learning, right? And then it relieves a load of learning. That's a very important thing. We talk of four types of loads when it comes to learning. One is a bag load. The other is what is called the curriculum load. The third is the transaction load. And the fourth is called the psychological load, right? So in the blended learning, the first three types of loads are eliminated, but the psychological load can only be minimized there, because the psychological load quite often can be driven by parents. The need for performance, the need to outwit others, the need to compete, all that can give you to the psychological load. But nevertheless, the bag load, the curriculum load, and the transaction load are minimized through blended learning. And the next important factor is it helps in multipolar learning. That is because you use different types of resources. You use video, you need to use audio, you need other experiential resources. I'm going to list you 20 different types of resources, and you'll find that the learner will have a choice. Again, I will take you to a comparison to a restaurant where you go to a five-star restaurant, you go to a buffet, you got 130 items over there, and you can't eat all the 130, but you will select five or six modes, right? Where you may select one dessert that you want, one soup that you want, and therefore, the choice of learning, you know, that multipolar learning, you've got a variety from which you can learn, and you can learn from everything, and you can learn from one thing over that. And then it helps the learner to pace his learning from time to time. So, the pace of learning is moderated. He can learn at his own speed at a given time. Maybe, he learns something in mathematics, he stops it and goes back, I will learn after half an hour, because the right brain and the left brain go on shifting there in their performance frequently. And therefore, he can adapt himself to the pace of learning depending upon his aptitude, interest, ecosystem, and several other things. That it encourages co-construction of knowledge. It's a very important thing, that because we, neurocognitive approaches very clearly state, and also it's supported by the NEP, that knowledge is always co-constructed. Co-construction of knowledge happens not only through self-learning, but it's also through peer learning, is also through the teacher. In other words, teacher and children become participants in construction of knowledge. What we call the collaborative learning, it becomes possible in the blended learning model. And therefore, the social constructivism of knowledge through online approaches is facilitated through the blended learning. That's one of the things. It is highly inclusive, right? Being a universal approach, you can have all kinds of input put across. Integrated software can be developed over there. You can have physical education, you can have social consciousness, you can have a cultural input put together. So, which a normal teacher in the classroom may not be able to accommodate all kinds of things to develop and design a curriculum, whereas the blended curriculum can facilitate integration, if not everything, but at least a few can be integrated. So it becomes an inclusive curriculum, an inclusive approach. And last but not the least over there, it provides opportunities for different number of assessment tools. One of the factors the NDP talks about is the 3D assessment. One is the self-assessment of the learner. The second is the peer assessment of the learner. The third is called the teacher-driven assessment. Now, with technology being aside, with a blended learning gives a variety of opportunities for this. That the blended learning gives enough opportunities also for assessment for learning, assessment on learning, and assessment as learning. So all these three things can be touched upon with blended learning. In other words, what I'm trying to say is blended learning is only a paradigm shift in the pedagogy that we are adopting. It is not based on the content. It is only how do you package the content is important. In other words, I'm going to give you some examples. You will find the pedagogy is the approach of blended learning is to develop a learning culture. It is not to prepare a child for IIT or a competitive examination, but is focusing on development of a learning culture, because we are in a society where we need to continuously learn. So here the pedagogist becomes a leader. Every teacher becomes a leader because he is a thought leader. He is how he integrates the way the children learn. And therefore, every teacher becomes a thought leader here. And I've already said that the sensory integration, I don't want to go deep into this issue, because that itself will take another half an hour, 40 minutes time over here. And therefore, please remember that the five senses get integrated into that, right? So when it comes to digital learning, one aspect I said is the digital learning. Digital learning has got two dimensions. One is a synchronous model, and the other is an asynchronous model. Now, in the school situation, we are mostly using the asynchronous model and not the synchronous model at this point of time, right? Beautiful way of doing that is integrating both. Now, when people talk to me that about digital learning, I go back to my own days in 1977 when the Tamil Nadu the Doordarshan came with educational television. I had the fortune of teaching chemistry for 1 year on the television. I knew at that time the technology was not at all comfortable. That every time you go online and teach to the students, it was indeed like going to battlefront. You got to be absolutely thorough. You don't know what will go wrong at what point of time. So you got to be extremely careful over that. But with 35 years now from on, the technology has come. But nevertheless, one important thing is that the kind of online teaching that we are providing is not at all the right model that we do. Because in a good online model, an effective teacher, a performing teacher should not be more than 30 to 40% of time on the screen. But now most teachers tend to remain in the screen 90 to 95% and 5% is for visuals and others who are there. The process should reverse with teachers participating only to 30 to 40 minutes and the rest 60% of time for being the other integrations to happen. So we have the three important dimensions: the online flipped model, the heuristic model, and the blended model. Flipped model, pretty well that you send the content to the children well in advance at home. The children come prepared, and then when you come back to the class, the teacher converts the class into an engaging model where there is a participation, question answer, debate, quiz, number of things happen, and therefore it is interactivity which is happening around. Heuristic model refers to a question answer based model, what we call the Socratic model of education, or even an Upanishadic model, we had the question answers coming through. So all the three, but all these are coming under the blended learning. So what are the advantages of the blended classroom as we go through? It encourages activity, it encourages participation, it encourages teamwork, it enhances self-confidence of the learner because everyone becomes a participant. It also improves the thinking skills. But the challenge for the teachers and the challenge for school heads is that preparing the content for the online model or blended model is not very easy. Please don't think that whatever my teacher does in the regular classroom is good enough. Not at all. Both are entirely different. Preparing a content is a very difficult job for that. So every school principal teacher needs to have a separate committee on designing e-content for the children, because it has got to be gravitating, it has got to be content rich, it should be only spotlight, not the descriptive and narrative. So the children come and discuss, it should be provocative, thoughtful, analytical, and researching. That's a very important dimension in the last one, because the national policy also talks about the research aspect of the blended learning, right? So a good blended classroom has the following elements: peer discussions, teacher discussion, brainstorming, quizzing, problem solving, project designing, and enabling further reading, right? So now, how to blend learning? That's a question that you will have. See, blending, I've already said, is in a universal umbrella model. So all that what you need is academic content with art, music, and theater, life skills, co-scholastic. You know, the NDP has already taken out the barrier between scholastic and co-scholastic activities. Therefore, you have to integrate your content design accordingly, physical and health education. You know, all for you, you have to apply your mind. And that's why I said, designing the e-content is not going to be an easy job. It will take 2 years to do that, right? It is not overnight. So probably you'll have to put appropriate committees in your schools to do that. So all these kinds of inputs have to be in the model. So for, I'll just walk into, you know, when it comes to blended learning, you've got 12 different models of blended learning. I'm not going to elaborate on that because in India, we are in the baby step, right? In the baby step, you are just learning to cope with blended learning. And when I talk about these 12 different models, the challenge is all these models are developed by different types of market people. And therefore, you will find that it is suitable to there. But we will not worry about that. We will just go into the one model of what I have talked to you, blending of everything together. With and remember one thing. The blend will vary different from Erode to Malappuram, Malappuram to Nagarkoil, because the blend has to be prepared locally. For, you know, in other words, the local culture, the local thought process, the local clientele, the local competencies of the teacher have all been taken into consideration to blend the model over there. So that's not right to see who what the others are doing, but you have to do it yourself. It is like just like preparing a good food at your kitchen rather than buying it from outside. Okay, so I'm just going to put 5 questions to the teachers and then give you the resources. So the questions that you have for the teachers, have you developed a psychological climate for learning? Please, principal also will note that you will be, because preparing your parents is going to be a hell of a difficult job. Because parents have all come through with a linear thinking of what they have learned, and therefore they think that's all the possible, and somewhat they can go for online learning now. But remember, you might take 1 year to convince the parents that there's a paradigm shift happening in the field of education, and the children are not going to lay, they have the way as they had in their days. Is your content gravitating? I've already said the preparation of content is going to be the most important problem. Do you have strategies for both personal engagement and group engagement? That's a very important thing. Teachers are trained. They think that online they can deal only with a single child. It is not necessary. The teachers have to prepare a collaborative model for this kind of thing. So please note that. Last but not the thing is, do you facilitate? So people also say, sir, in online teaching, in blended learning, we cannot really appreciate the child. sorry, it's not true, right? You have to have more strategies for that, right? In other words, the best example I'll give you, through blended learning, you only, light the fire in the belly of the child. In other words, he becomes a self-learner, right? I will just go into, so what are the different resources that you would need? This is my last few slides for you. Very important, right? Every principal should note. First important thing is that you need your textbook. Never ever think that blended learning is going to discard your textbook. Online learning is going to discard your textbook. Textbooks are here to stay for 25 years, right? In other words, right, your flight cannot take off without without a road to take a takeoff point, right? Similarly, textbooks are the road map for future learning. So don't ever think that textbooks can be eliminated. They will continue to be there. They will be the foundations on which even the blended learning will happen. But we are also moving to the e-content of the learning. E-content is being provided by many publishers, outsiders, many technology companies over there. There are schools where the teachers themselves prepare the e-content, and that's a very interesting model that they do. But please remember, the preparation of e-content is entirely a different ball game. You have got to apply. I remember, in 70s, I used to have three stages of content prepared for my children, casseted and the audio when I happened to be a principal. So different models are available. The third is going to be, what do you call, your workbooks. Now many schools are using workbooks, whatnot, for doing the work, practical work. Even your practical work is going to be online in the days to come. As a matter of fact, in 1997, in one of my books, which I wrote called Mindscaping Education, I wrote about the virtual laboratories on the map, and I got a good comment from Dr. Abdul Kalam. And I believe the day is not too far when most of your experiments, which are absolutely outdated, they are only a repetition of concepts, will become absolutely online. So the future holds a lot of promise for online, especially with artificial intelligence coming through, augmented reality is coming through, virtual realities and mixed reality is coming through. Most of your experiments will go online. You've got to be prepared for that, right? The next is going to be, online lessons. Remember, there is a difference between e-content and online lesson. E-content is what you prepare and allow the children to read at home, or maybe you keep it in the library and do it. But online classes are something which my teacher, when he or she does it, you record it and keep it in your library so that my child, one, the child has not able to attend the class, he can go and tap it out. If the child has gone to the class but could not learn, he can go and take it and learn. Third, the child has learned, but still you want to improve on that, he can do. So three levels of operation can be done online, and this could become a part of a great virtual library. Visual support. Many students may think that I don't want a textbook, I don't want e-content, but I want to see how the blood flow happens inside the body. I want only the dynamics of that, visuals. So every school can have a visual library where the visuals are stored right from KG class to the 12th class. Web resources. Every good teacher should know what are the web resources for each of their topic. No teacher shall enter the class without at least the knowledge of half a dozen web resources which support the formal learning. Self-learning libraries. The concept of libraries is fast changing, but you will find that print-based libraries will evaporate. Now, I've been suggesting the idea of online libraries for the school. A school can control the entire library and give it to children on their mobile. The children can read and come back. That will become a part of the blended learning. It will facilitate evaluation also. Last but not the least, you have the participative project work. Project work can be done within a classroom with 3-4 students, are within the sections of the school, are between schools, between Sahodiyas, all these things can be done. I've seen the schools participating at the international level and doing project in order to have what is called constructivist approach to learning process over there. Experiential learning resources, CBSE has told a number of things, but unfortunately, most of these resources are built and damaged and thrown out at this. Now the time has come when you can digitally store a number of these experiential resources. I think experiential learning itself is a different topic to deal with. Last but not the least, you've got social consciousness as a very important dimension of the learning. Now with technology around, blended learning calls for integration of social consciousness, because most children try to miss the group activities to largely, right? The NEP talks about current trends as well as GK, and with your technology aside, but with blended learning, we can go for quiz in each school that the current knowledge is to be facilitated. Self-assessment, I've already told you, the blended learning, it's going to be a part of that. Teacher-led assessment is going to be a part of that. And last but not the least, with blended learning, the heads of institutions, the academic coordinators, and the teachers will have to engage on digitally documenting learning. And that is the overall picture of what you call the blended learning, overall picture. I've just given you a bird's view of the whole thing, because to me, a blended learning program will indeed need one full day of 6 hours to be dealt with. But I'm sure you would have picked up a few points out of that. You can go and deliberate within your school, introspect. If you want any further resources on such topics over there, you can go to my website. You can go, it's known as balaspeaks.in, right? Or you can go to LinkedIn, where I've got more than 250 articles. Many of them deal with that. Or you can send a mail to me and talk to me. Thank you very passionately for passionate listening. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Wow. What an energy. We all are energized and we are charged today. It's really amazing. More than anything, we have learned how a teacher has to be in the class. It's really, we are still not come out of this. It's still hearing. The voice is still hearing. Thank you so much, sir. What an energy. That is what really I want to express here.
That's a teacher.
Yeah, thank you. And yeah, of course, education is no longer just pen and paper. Now it's blended with so many other things, and opportunities are plenty. And now the teachers are also should adopt this new normal. As you said, every day is a new normal. So all the teachers and the academic learners should get into this system. Any questions, participants? You're welcome. Any questions? Any questions, please?
Hi, can I unmute and speak?
Yeah, please, ma'am.
Yeah, my name is Jyoti and I live in Chennai. I was just wanting to Dr. Bala to answer a question, if he could distinguish between blended and hybrid learning. I know they are not the same, but I would like to hear his distinguishing between blended and hybrid learning. Thank you.
Can you unmute, sir?
I said, Jyoti, are you a student of science or humanities?
Humanities, Bala, humanities.
Yes. Never mind. But the point is, in the very sixth class, we talk about compounds and mixtures, right? The mixture is something where things are good together. You can take out at any point of time, but they will retain their own character. But when it comes to compound, all of them, then you transform into a new thing. Blended learning is like, a compound, and then hybrid learning is something like a mixture. That's a very simple way of understanding.
Thank you. I'll read up on my science and I'll try to figure out what you just said.
Oh, no. The point is, hybrid. What I'm trying to say is hybrid learning means that you try to put a few things together to facilitate the learner at a given point of time.
Yes.
Blended learning is a conceptual exercise that you do, right? To develop a process of learning in the child.
I understand. I understand. Hybrid is more about your own personal choices.
Which school are you from?
No, I'm a trainer myself. I'm a education.
Okay, great. Nice.
But I just like to listen to you. Every time I get the opportunity, I listen in. Thank you.
Many of us are like this only. Whenever we get the opportunity, we try to listen to him. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Any other question?
Yes, would I like to speak?
Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, sir. This is Bini Singh from Faizabad Tiny Dots.
Yeah, it's how are you?
Excellent to hear from you, sir. It's a treat always. So I just had a suggestion that you said there are three areas of assessment, the self-assessment, and the peer assessment, and obviously the teacher. But nowadays we take a lot of feedback. So I would feel the parental assessment also plays a great role in, because parents are actually have a lot of bonding with the students, especially during the lockdown time. So I hope that bonding continues and that fourth pillar of assessment will always be there, should always be there.
Well, I think you are very blessed to have a great set of parents who are able to give a feedback. But, you know, it's something where my personal experience is it is good to have it from them, but also you have to tread on a very safe path, you know. You may not know where it cuts when it cuts, right? So, because my experience with them, the one point with teaching community is that you cannot go to a doctor and say that I got a stomachache, please prescribe me Baralgon. He will say, get lost. You can't go to a lawyer and tell him that you say that, please argue my case under Section 14 of the Constitution. But here is a teacher and here is a principal. Anybody can come and tell you this is how you have to teach and we nod our head. Yeah, you are right. That's irony. So the question is, I don't mind so long the inputs that you receive from any corner are very professional. See, subjective elements are what you call, very fluid things should not be there. They need to be very professional. That's my view.
Thank you, sir. We will discuss more later.
Most welcome.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Any other question? Any other question? Yeah. Shall we move on? I'm so happy to invite Mr. C. Radhakrishnan, who is a passionate educational professional with 25 years of experience. And he has done many things. Collaborator, academic writer, teacher trainer, vice principal, principal, secretary, and the president of prestigious professional bodies and so on. The list is so high and we are so happy to invite Mr. C. Radhakrishnan, Director, CPT Programs, Panchatantra Planet, to give the upcoming programs.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. Bala sir, it is again so wonderful to listen to you. Last time we met at Hyderabad. And I never expected I will be able to listen to you in this pandemic. And I got such a wonderful opportunity today. Thank you so much for the wonderful, inspiring speech.
Thank you.
I'm an ardent fan of you on LinkedIn. I read almost all the writings. It's so inspiring and that helps me develop myself. Yeah, coming to the point. The duty entrusted me is to introduce the coming up programs of Panchatantra Planet. Next week, that is on 30th June, we are coming up with another program, a panel discussion. And we will be discussing on academic year 2021-22 challenges. And four eminent principals are coming up for this panel discussion. Mr. Santosh Chakravarti ma'am, Anjali Rajdan, and also Commander Sir, all these four people will be discussing on different issues that is going to come up in 2021-22. We will be dealing with academic delivery. We will be dealing with assessment issues. We will be dealing with emotional issues, and also we'll be dealing with cybersecurity issues when children are online. So I hope each and every participant of this session will attend next week's session also. Then on 7th July, we are coming up with an art integration program. In that, one of the most famous flutist is coming on our platform to tell you how to integrate music with our classroom or our subjects that we teach in the class. And after that too, we are planning different types of programs that can help you improve your classroom delivery of lessons online and offline. So I hope most of you will come to the platform on Wednesdays for our free webinar sessions. And all these webinars we are providing you free of cost, because we know during this pandemic, it is not the time to do much business. People like Balasar is with us to help us deliver amazingly good resources with you all, so we can all jointly come up and do the best in the classroom, in the online platform, to help the children improve in their academics and support them emotionally. So thank you so much. Over to Subbalakshmi ma'am.
Thank you, Radhakrishnan sir. And there are some participants have asked Bala sir to once again repeat your web page.
Okay. My web page is Bala Speaks, B-A-L-A, Bala Speaks, .in. Bala Speaks, .in.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Really, it's a great session. And I invite Mr. Anish Kumar, Principal of EMS Pukottupadam. Principal EMS Pukottupadam. And he's the General Secretary of Malappuram Central Sahodaya, and he's also the executive member of Confederation of Kerala Sahodaya Complexes. Sir, propose the oath of thanks.
Good evening to everyone. So, I don't know how to start. This is Balasar. This is the second session with you. The first one that organized by the Confederation of Kerala Sahodayas in the last week. Sir, it was a wonderful session. The last session that conducted by the Confederation was also one of the excellent sessions that the CBSE fraternity got this academic year. And so this session also, already everybody is saying that everyone, every single word that we got from your side was marvelous, and nothing will be removed from your speeches. So it was a wonderful session, and it will be what this academic year in this COVID situation, in this pandemic situation, everybody, around 800 principals or the educationalists are here. It will be a good asset for this academic year. So here, my duty is to deliver a word of thanks to everybody, those who are participated in this session. So the primary things that we have to share, our resource person, Dr. Balasubramanian sir, the speaker of today's on blended learning, and a well-known academician and the former director of CBSE. On behalf of the entire team, I express our sincere thanks to you, sir. Bala sir, thank you one more time. Then the moderator of this session, Mrs. Subbalakshmi, the secretary of Kongu Sahodaya, and she moderated and controlled this session fantastically, and in an excellent way she moderated it. Thank you, ma'am, for your wonderful moderation and wonderful controlling of the session. And Mr. Mugesh Shailaj, everybody know him, is the delivered the welcome address on behalf of this Panchatantra, Konku, and Malappuram Central Sahodayas. And all the directors of Panchatantra Planet, they organized this session. On behalf of the entire participants of this session, I express our sincere gratitude to you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Once again,
and all the Konku officials of Konku and Malappuram Central Sahodaya, on behalf of the entire participants of this session, I express a special thanks to all the officials of Konku and Malappuram Central Sahodaya. And moreover, we know Dr. Ramasubramanian, the president of Konku Sahodaya, and Mr. Radhakrishnan, the director of Pajadandra, for arranging this type of wonderful session. Once again, I express a sincere gratitude to all the participants, those who spent around 1.5 hours for this session. A special congrats and thanks to our Balasar for this type of wonderful session. Once again, I express a sincere gratitude to all the participants. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Anish sir. And once again, thank you, Bala sir. It's really a wonderful session. We got to know many things, especially we got energy today. Now people are into this 10th standard marks, 5 standard marks. So many things are going on, but today we are really charged. So thank you so much for the energy passing. More than anything, basically I feel, especially from my side personally, I feel that we got that energy from you and the positivity. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. And thank you so much all the other participants for joining us. And we'll meet once again in a wonderful session like this. Let's wind up. Thank you.
Thank you. So once again, from the side of Panchatantra Planet, I would like to thank each and every participant, especially to Bala sir, and also both Konku and Malappuram Central Sahodaya for associating with us, deciding to partner with us for this wonderful session. Thank you so much, ma'am, and also Anish Babu, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Convey our regards to all the Sahodaya members of Konku and
ma'am?
Also.
Sure.
Good evening, ma'am.
Malappuram Sahodaya. Yes. Somebody is there. Please.
Thank you so much.
One minute.
It was really a wonderful session, ma'am. Behalf of others, we would really like to thank all, ma'am. And do we get a certificate for the session, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, if you have registered, you will get.
Yeah, sir, registered. Thank you, sir.
Okay,
thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.